softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we are thankful, Lord, as we meet to celebrate a life that has been well lived, that we can be reminded that you have not made us for darkness or death, but you have made us for life with you forever. And with you we have hope, and with you we have nothing to fear. We ask, Lord, for your words of eternal life to lift us, to encourage us, to vanquish our anxiety and our fears, and may we be reminded of your presence as your love goes before us and is present with us. In Christ's name, amen. Family, it is a privilege to be here with you all today to commemorate, to celebrate, and to be thankful for the life of your father, your father-in-law, your grandpa and papa, and all of those things he was to you. And friends and church friends, thank you so much for your love and your presence as we remember the life which he lived. Mr. Roger William Shipman, 84, was born in Georgetown, Ohio, to the late John William Shipman and Tina Ellen Carrington Shipman. He was an educator and coach for 44 years, most of that time with Madera City Schools in Ohio. He was a member of several coaches and teacher groups throughout the years, and a former member of Mount Carmel Baptist Church in Cincinnati, Ohio. On moving to Waycross in 2006, he became a member of Second Baptist Church. In addition to his parents, He was also preceded in death by his wife of 46 years, Paulette Sue Gill Shipman. Survived by two daughters, Robin Rapp with Tom of Cincinnati, Reagan Petrie with Donald of Waycross, a son, Ryan Shipman of New York, and three grandchildren, Mackenzie Rapp, Marshall Rapp, and Rebecca Petrie. If you had the privilege of knowing Roger, and most of us in this room outside of you family members have known him since he moved to Georgia 18 years ago, you know that there is so much in an obituary that is between those lines. And some of those lines that are in there carry so much. 44 years as a teacher and coach. Let me tell you something about that there. That was the 44 years that he was paid to be a teacher and coach. He told me just 8 days ago that he loved the fact, and he felt like everyone else should also have this if they could, that he had a profession that he could do his entire life. And he believed that. He believed that he could keep on teaching, and he believed that he could keep on coaching. And we'll talk more about this as I share about him. But he believed that because he believed in people. And he believed in people far more than they believed in themselves. He believed the capacity that they had to do and to give was far greater than what they had. I've used the last 2 days to look back at his Facebook page and see some of the comments that are shared on there from former students and colleagues and all. And one of the things that we forget about here, those of us who knew him from the basketball coach standpoint, was that he was actually a teacher, and evidently a pretty good teacher, and a chemistry teacher. And it was interesting, Tommy, you said this the other day, and then I looked, and multiple people said that their interest in the career field that they are now in, and three of them it was in medicine, was sparked by their time in his classroom learning chemistry. What an incredible thought, because if he did that for some with chemistry, think about what he's done for just his outlook on life that he transported and carried those students through and know of it. Several of the comments there that the former students would share as they talked about him, some of the things that the words they would use were he was consoling, he was inspirational, he had a magic impact, a leader, an influencer in the true sense of the word, is someone who helped people chart the course of their life and to shape their life. There are a lot of things that go into making a good teacher, but just a few of those are the interest and a love for the subject that is being taught, and then a love and a concern for those whom they are teaching. Roger had both of those. If you knew him from the sports side, he absolutely loved sports. It has been said that Miss Paulette on more than one occasion told him that he loved sports more than he loved them. And he did love sports. But I'll also say that Miss Paulette also went, as you all have shared, to every single one of the games that he coached. Unless you all were playing your own game and she had to be there, she was at all the games that he coached. So maybe she should shoulder some of that blame herself. Roger had an analytical mind. He loved numbers. He loved the data. He loved seeing the things that were there. And because of that, they were sharing about how he could sit and tell you the students who sat in his classroom, what seat they sat in, what number they wore if they played a sport, and which number they might have worn if they played more than one sport. You know, it does take a love for numbers to have some of that ability, but it also takes an intense desire for the well-being of those whom he's focused on. Roger is enshrined in two Hall of Fames for his coaching up in Ohio. And one of them just caught my eye, and I wanted to read the few sentences that are there says this: provided leadership and excellence in coaching girls and boys basketball, boys soccer, football, softball, and boys and girls track for over 22 seasons. Now listen to this. This is what is written about his Hall of Fame enshrinement with the Madera school system. His teams won as he showed his players compassion and direction. What an incredible thing to say about a coach. That the results were what he believed about his players more so than what happened in the win and loss column. But don't get it wrong, Roger deeply cared about the win and loss column. We had him, the privilege of him coaching and helping in our upper basketball league for many years, and I can assure you that Roger wanted to win. He would come to me and he would say, "Do the rules really mean this?" "They absolutely do, Roger." And he would say, "Well, but we could also do this." "I understand that, and you understand that, but no other coach here is going to understand that. So we got to go by what we understand." But I can tell you this, that every kid, he can still remember. I mean, this is when he was in his 70s. He can still remember some of the things that they did and their names. And then he's had the privilege, and I know he had this privilege to some degree in the school system, but then he's had the privilege that he did it for such a length of time here that he began to coach with some of the girls that he had coached. What an incredible witness for who he was and who he is as a person. I found a quote. It's written by a former Kentucky coach, and so I thought it was interesting because of that, but Roger had a deep love for Kentucky basketball. That was followed by a deep love for Cincinnati basketball and a deep love for Louisville basketball and, on down the... But Kentucky was at the forefront. But Adolph Rupp had this to say: if a coach is determined to stay in the coaching profession, he will develop from year to year. This much is true. No coach has a monopoly on the knowledge of basketball. There are no secrets in the game. The only secrets, if there are any, are good teaching and sound fundamentals, an intelligent handling of men, a sound system of play, and the ability to instill in the boys a desire to win. He certainly did that. He certainly did that. There was a night that in the last few years of him coaching, he had kind of struggled a little bit with making all of the games from one illness or another. And I believe the particular culprit at this point was vertigo. And he had told me, he said, "You're going to have to coach the team." And so I did, and it was one of those nail-biting middle school games, girls' games, that was 7-7 at the very end. And if you've suffered or experienced some of those games, you know what those are like. So we went into overtime. And the first minute of overtime, a little girl on our team who rarely touched the ball, never touched the ball on purpose, was in the middle of the lane, and the rebound bounced to her. She grabbed it, she shot it, and she made it. And that was the final score, 9-7. I called him that night, and I told him who had scored and how it had happened. And I think he heard the shock in my voice. And he kind of, looking back now, he kind of chided me a little bit. And he said, "Well, that's why we practice that." I understand why we practice it. I just didn't feel like it was going to make a difference for that girl. But he did. But that's who he was. He would look at someone and say, "They can do it. And they can do it." And there's no group of people he believed in any more than you right here. You could not have a conversation with Roger Shipman without hearing about Robin, Ryan, and Reagan. But to hear about Robin was also to hear about Tom and to hear about Mackenzie and to hear about Marshall. And to hear about Ryan was to hear about Donetta and the travel and the different things and where he was going to next. And to hear about Reagan was to hear about Don and Becca and then Don's family, because he knew that I knew them too. So, I mean, to hear from Roger was to hear about his family. He loved you all immensely. As I was looking back on some of his things just a few weeks ago, he had posted something, and it was in reference to Paulette's passing and the time since then. And it kind of hit me that there's no way he's adding this up on a piece of paper somewhere. This is in his head. And then when I talked to you all, y'all told me, yes, that was in his head. He had kept such track of things that he was able to think about them. So when you would talk to him about you, it wasn't just about you. It was about the people in your life and the circumstances of your life, because the love that he carried for you all was a deep love. And he wanted to think of every way that impacted you all. As I said earlier, when you scroll through his page and you scroll through some of the sharings that you all have done, and then the responses of former students and your peers and all who went to school and were coached and led by him, there's a unifying theme that he believed in them more than they believed in themselves. Oh, he believed in you all. He believed in you, Robin, and your family. Ryan, you. He loved to tell us where you were traveling, where you had gone to, where you were headed to next. He didn't love you all for the hope that one day you would make him proud. He loved you all because of the fact that he was already present and saw your lives as something to be celebrated. Reagan, he wanted to make sure everyone knew of who you were and what you were doing. Don shared the other day about how overjoyed he was when you were enshrined in that same Hall of Fame, and that he was more excited about what happened for you than he was for himself. And if you knew Roger, you knew that's the truth. That's who he was. And Roger loved Paulette. A conversation with him would quickly turn to the number of years it had been since she had passed. He would remark about the things that had happened since then. And if you talked very long and he got sentimental at all, and it wouldn't take him long to get there, he would start talking about the things that he couldn't believe that she had missed, the things that she hadn't seen with him. Think about the things that he did since she passed away. And probably, to me, the thing that I thought was so impactful was you sharing that your mother was a hugger and Roger was not. But over 15 years ago, he became a hugger. That after she passed, I don't know if he thought you needed it, he knew he needed it, whatever it was, he said, I'll pick up that. And he did. And he hugged you all from what you all have said, probably more so in the last 15 years than he had prior. He was sentimental. He didn't change the towels in the bathroom, the fancy decorative ones that people hang for no reason, because Miss Paulette had put them there. And he didn't want to change them. Painted the bathrooms because she wanted them painted, but then put the towels right back. Kept the plant. It was a way of him keeping alive the memories that the two of them shared together. And for him to be reminded that while she was not physically present with him, that he still regarded her and loved her. Doesn't mean she didn't more than one occasion, like you said, accuse him of loving sports or television more than he loved you all. I want to read you a poem that his father wrote and gave to him as he was entering fatherhood himself. Probably would have been about 10 or 12 years in, based on the ages of you all. And then we're going to hear a song that was his and Paulette's song. But his father wrote a poem that says this: I saw a father in my backyard with three happy little ones. I watched a while, then told myself that's the way it should be done. I once had a little boy, but I let him slip away. And with a lot of I love yous, he didn't hear me say. It wasn't because I didn't care or listen to what he said. It just seems you spend all of life trying to get ahead. But after you have made your mark and look back at what you did, the happiest times were spent together, just being one of the kids. Your dad was your dad, but your dad was also a friend in the sense that he believed in you and believed that supporting you was worthwhile.
Sail on, silver girl. Sail on.
In John chapter 14, it's a passage that we're very much familiar with. Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says to them, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well." One of the groups I haven't mentioned today was Roger's love for the Gideons and his love for helping them and sharing God's word. Roger also had a very sentimental side, as I mentioned, and because of that, maybe he would have approved of these scriptures because they are often read at moments like this. But they're read at moments like this because they mean something, and they carry an extra weight with us. Just as the disciples were troubled, we too are troubled. You, family, are troubled. And grief will and is great. And so Jesus is helping prepare them for the fullness of what is yet to be known and realized. He points them to the reminder that it was not for them to attain up to God, but rather for their faith in the person of Jesus to secure it on their behalf. And even though they didn't fully understand that, that did not keep Jesus from reiterating what he had done and reminding them that all of the goodness of God is fully found in Jesus. All the mercy of God is fully found in Jesus. And all of the forgiveness of God is fully found in Jesus. The disciples were continuing to be confused like you and I are sometimes. Well, yes, but how? And what is else going to be? And Jesus says, well, if you've seen me, then you've seen the Father. If you want to know who God is, look to the person of Jesus. And for us today that are left here, as Roger has departed from here, this is our hope for unification with him once again. The person, this Jesus, the one who brought the fullness of life to the man that you all and we all loved and knew. Psalm chapter 23. I want to read it to you, family, because I want to remind you that the God of Psalm 23 was the God of your father, and he'll be yours as well. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The God who shepherded your father will also shepherd you. The God whom he believed in to the degree that all those around him were impacted by his belief in them, he will also shepherd you. The God who led him into places of rest and security, places that allowed him to realize that he could provide for others and give to others, will also lead you into places of rest and security. The God who restored him, the God who gave him hope each day, will also work in restoring you all and giving you hope each day. So much of your grief of losing your father, your grandfather, your papa, your father-in-law is yet to come. And each of you will meet it differently. The moments and the spaces that are no longer filled by his physical presence will be very real. And so I remind you and I ask you to show grace to each other, to encourage each other, to adapt as your father adapted in the passing of your mother, and treasure things that maybe you didn't quite treasure before in a way that makes it more real. And in those moments and in those places and as you do those things, God will restore your soul. Little moments will be meaningful, and little reminders will help direct us as we place our trust in the fact that God is present. He is the same God. He will walk with you as he has walked with your father. For those of you all here, part of many of us here through Second Baptist Church, we are reminded of what we had and what we celebrate in the person of someone who loves so well and serves so well among us. And we are reminded of God's faithfulness and God's tenderness when we hear of the faithfulness and tenderness of one who was made in his image. I'm going to pray, and we'll close with Amazing Grace. Almighty God, we commit this family to you. Lord, we have been blessed immeasurably by knowing Roger. His family has received his love and comfort and care for all of their lives. And yes, you have remained faithful in giving them grace. God, we ask that you would comfort them with memories that will lead them to both laughing and crying. We ask that you sustain them in your faithfulness and in your promise and hope of redemption. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amazing grace.
the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was blind.